when the accretion rate is very high, even say higher than the eigen accretion rate, we will find systems become more and more important. So for the standard synthesis, if the accretion, in that case, the accretion rate is low, we will find that these two terms will balance with each other. This term can be neglected. However, when the accretion rate becomes very high, we will find that this term and this term, these two will balance with each other.
So that's because due to photon track, so entropy increases.
Mainly because the photon trapping, this term also become very small. I will explain next slide. You always ask me questions in my next slide.
Very good. Because all of you shut
up. So in this case, we have a so-called photon trapping lead. Photon trapping means when the accretion rate is very high, the density of the accretion flow is very high. So in that case, it is very difficult for the photons to escape from the accretion flow, radiated away. So this means these terms are very small. So this is also why these two terms will balance with each other. Okay. And we can imagine in that case, another important effect will be the temperature of the accretion flow will be much higher than that of the standard synthesis. This is because radiation becomes very difficult, very weak. So all the viscous dissipation have to be stored in the accretion flow. This will make the accretion flow temperature very high. And this is another important effect. And also because temperature is high, the geometry of the disk also will also change. Because as I mentioned in, just now, when the temperature is high, so the thickness of the accretion flow will become larger. So in that case, the disk will become thin, not thick. Now let's just look at the photon trapping effect. This is the key point of this thin disk model. So this is a symmetric figure, of course. So some photons, when they are produced in the accretion flow, usually they can escape out of the accretion disk by diffusion process. Diffusion means collide with other particles many, many times and gradually escape. So you can imagine when the accretion rate becomes higher, this diffusion time, which is described with this, this quantity, will become very large. Okay. So within a certain radius or given the accretion rate, we will have the diffusion time will become even larger than the accretion time. This means once the photons are produced in the accretion flow, they have not got enough time to escape. They already be swallowed by the black hole because they are trapped in by the gas, swallowed by the black hole horizon. So these photons finally cannot escape. They sacrifice, they find them back into the black hole. Okay. So this is the photon trapping effect. This is some numerics, mathematics. This is a basic picture. To see some more details, let's look at the global solution. What's the meaning of the global solution? Global solution means, global means from innermost radius, the accretion flow to very large radius. We'll get a solution throughout this region. And it is not a local solution. So this means we cannot draw the algebra equations. Algebra means local. So we have to consider differential terms in the equation. Okay, this is a global solution mean. This is because for thin disk, all these differential terms become important. They cannot be approximated by algebra equations. Okay. So to solve the global solution, we have to satisfy three boundary conditions. One is the out boundary condition of the equation flow at a very large radius. So we have to satisfy the given temperature, density, radial velocity of the accretion flow. And also, very important condition is we have to satisfy the sonic point condition. What does it mean? So sonic point means At this point, this is a specific radius in the accretion flow. At this radius, the radial velocity of the accretion flow is equal to the local sound speed. In this case, we call it a sonic point. Okay. So for black hole accretion, we can show exactly the black hole, the accretion flow, the radial velocity must be equal to the speed of light when they enter into the black hole horizon. So this means at a very large radius, the velocity of course very small, and at the black hole horizon, it must be equal to the speed of light. So between these two locations, there must be some radius where the radial velocity of the accretion flow is equal to the local sound speed. In other words, the accretion flow must pass through this sonic point. Yes. So this is another sonic boundary condition we have to satisfy for global solution. Yes. Of course, another one is an inner boundary condition at the horizon of black hole. Yes. So mathematically, this is a three boundary condition. Even for the mathematicians, this is a very difficult problem to solve. Unfortunately, this condition for some specific description of a viscosity, for example, this can be automatically satisfied. So actually, we only need to deal with these two boundary conditions. But this is still a not easy problem, not trivial. So usually, we use these two methods to solve this equation. One is a shooting, another is a relaxation. You can look at the detail of these two methods by looking at the famous book, Numerical Steps. So this is the result taken from this paper. This is Ron Pan, a professor in IAA, some of you know. So this is his student, a Chinese. This plot showed the angular velocity as the function of the radius. Okay, you can see this is a capillary. So some region it is a super capillary, but another region it is sub capillary. This is because the temperature is very high. So the gradient of the gap pressure already play an important role. So in this case, not only the gravitational force and the centrifugal force balance with each other, but also the gradient also play an important role. This figure shows the radial velocity of the accretion flow. And this this is the ratio between radial velocity and the local sound speed. So this one, this zero means they are equal to each other. This is not the law, right? So this is a sonic point. So you can see all these solutions pass through this sonic point. And this is the pressure. Okay. This is a different curves based on the different mystery. Okay. And this is the radiation. So you can see when the equation rate becomes higher and higher, the vacuum play a more important role. So this dotted line means a very low accretion rate. In this case, the convection is almost zero. This is the standard thin disk case. Or thin disk become more and more important. Yeah, this is a very long example. Now look at the radiation of thin disk. because of the convection, now we have such kind of a relationship. This is the effective temperature of the accretion flow. It is proportional to R2 minus 2. So if you are familiar with the theory of standard thin disk, you will know this result is different from that of the thin disk. So for thin disk, the temperature is proportional to R2 minus 3 over 4 over 3. Now it is different, okay, to 1 over 2. So because of this difference, the spectrum also changed, okay, because temperature profile, the radio profile now change. Yes. And also another important thing is for slim disk, the radiative efficiency has become lower compared to the thin disk. This is because of the photo trapping effect I emphasized just now. So the photons, although they are produced, they cannot freely or easily escape from the accretion flow. They are stored in the accretion flow and swallowed by the black hole. So this is why relative efficiency become low. Okay. But luminosity can still be higher than adiabatic luminosity. We just increase the accretion rate, so we can still easily exceed the So this is why at the beginning of my lecture I emphasized adding luminosity is only an upper limit of spherical accretion. So once we have some angular momentum, luminosity can easily exceed this. Well, before I introduce applications, I want to say something more. Because I have not put it into my lecture because of the time limit, but I should emphasize it. All this picture I introduced are relatively old. Okay. They are roughly, say, about 20 years ago. Okay. In recent years, especially in recent 5 years also, because again, because of the rapid development of numerical simulation, now we can do very detailed radiative transfer MHD simulation.
Specifically,
we can simulate slim disk. Okay. Simulate the case when the accretion bridge is very high. So we found that the picture changed somewhat compared to this traditional picture. Okay. One most important effect is we found that the photon tracking effect now is not as important as before. Why? This is because now all these pictures were obtained by a one-dimensional approximation. Okay. Only consider one-dimensional in the analytical solution. Okay. Now, by numerical simulation, we can do at least the two-dimensional things. So because of this extension, we identify one new mechanism for energy transport, which is in the vertical direction of the accretion disk. Previously, people think photons can only diffuse in along the vertical direction. Now, people found there is a new mechanism, which is people called magnetic buoyancy. So this is something very similar to the parking stability I mentioned before. So there is some bubbles of the magnetic fields. So these bubbles, the density is lower than the surrounding media. So these bubbles will feel the buoyant force. It will easily escape from the accretion flow and escape from the accretion flow to the corona region. So this turned out to be a very efficient way of energy escape along the vertical direction compared to the traditional diffusion. So this is why now people found for a slim disk, the radiative efficiency is much higher than this traditional picture. And the photo trapping is not as important as before, as people think before. So this is what I want to emphasize. Again, this comes up for a very new result is done by Yan Fei Jiang and Jim Stone. Okay. Because currently they are ready to transfer a method, the multiplication method is the best in the world. So they obtain a lot of new results. This means how powerful it is in approximation. So the possible application of slim disk are possible because there is still some debate. Okay. One is narrow line safety one galaxy. This kind of special AGA. So people think that such kind of AGA accretion rate is quite high. Another one is ultra-luminescent resources. Okay. Then SS for 3-speed and some AGA. Then I would like to mention one puzzle, which I call it the super-editing puzzle. Because from the theory of the super-editing accretion, a black hole accretion can easily exceed the editing luminosity. Okay, the only condition we need is there is enough gas supply filling of the black hole. Okay. So this is the theory it tells us. However, observational results seem to be different. So this figure shows the observational result from this paper. They combine, they collect the data from a Sloan digital sky survey, maybe several tens of thousands of AGA, and they put it in this figure. So this line shows the editing limit. So you can see very few source AGA exceeds this editing limit. Most of them are sub-editing. So this is a kind of a puzzle. Why theoretically we expect black hole accretion can easily exceed the editing limit, but observationally seem to be all below editing, or most of them below editing limit. Okay. I think the possible reason this is one project in my school we are doing now. So we think that the cooperation is because of feedback. So if the central EGN is very strong, it will emit very strong radiation and wind. This will push the gas around the black hole away. So the pressure weight will be automatically decreased. So this can be, this is a self-controlled magnetism. Okay, this is the end of the first two chapters. Now, let's turn to the third chapter, hot accretion flow, to introduce this dynamics and radiation. So first, let's introduce one-dimensional dynamics. Again, let's go back to the one-dimensional equations. I think you already see this, this is the third time I show these equations. So energy conservation, momentum equation, and also energy equation. This is for one temperature equation flow. This is for two temperature. Two temperature energy equation. This one is to describe energy equation for ions. This one is to describe energy equation for electrons. Okay. So one temperature means the electron and the ions have the same temperature. Two temperature means their temperature different. So why different? There are two possible, two reasons. One is the heating source, which is turbulent dissipation or viscous dissipation. Preferably, maybe only heat ions. Okay. Now, people, the current idea is it can also heat electrons, but maybe not as much as to ions. The more important reason is radiation. All radiation is different for ions and electrons. Because the mass of the ions is 1,000 times, 2,000 times heavier than electrons. So electrons is much more powerful to radiate their energy than ions. This means the temperature will, of the electrons will be lower than temperature of the ions. And this is why we have typically two temperature equation flow. By the way, this is also the case. This is this picture. Although it's difficult to be confirmed by observation or black hole accretion, it already been confirmed by another field, so a supernova remnant study, and also solar wind. Okay, we only need to look at the energy equation. This is again, this is the gradient of the entropy, TdS equals dU minus PdV. Okay. Gradient of entropy equals the gradient of internal energy minus the compression work. And this the right hand side of the equation describes this one is the viscous dissipation. Another, this one is radiative cooling for electrons. For ions, this is the viscous dissipation. And this is the coupling between ions and the electrons. For ions, because the ions temperature is higher, so this is a cooling term. But for electrons, this is a heating term. So these equations are differential equations. So we have a lot of differential terms. However, we can make some assumption, simplification, to assume all these quantities like velocity, temperature, and so on. They are function, they are power law function of radius. This is assumption. So once we make this assumption, we can put this into these differential equations. Then all these differential terms will become into algebra terms. Then we can obtain the so-called self-similar solutions. Okay. This is the result. So now we can see the result is quite simple. It very looks at least apparently quite similar to the result of standard set disk. So they are all functions, power law functions of the mass, black hole, accretion rate, radius, and so on. Okay. This is velocity, angular velocity, sound speed, which is equivalent of the temperature, density, magnetic field strength, pressure, viscous dissipation. This is the electron scattering optical depth. So what is the main features of this hot accretion flow solution. It's a self-similar solution. So this is not so easy to just look at these mathematical equations. But the more we are more interested to the physics. So physics is here. So one is the velocity, the radial velocity of the fish solution is much larger than that of the thin disk. So this is the radial velocity. Okay. So just look at this result. You can see for thin disk, h over r is much, much smaller, right? Because this is the definition of the thin disk. The h is much, much smaller than the radius. And also, this is the sun speed. For thin disk, temperature is several orders of magnitude lower than hot accretion flow. So this quantity for thin disk is also much smaller. So even so, just look at this result, you can see for thin disk, radial velocity will be much, much smaller than the hot accretion flow. Another feature is the rotation is subcapillary. This is because gap pressure is very important. Third one is the temperature is very hot. The temperature even close to the thermal temperature, or here I call it a zero temperature. So you may remember the first or second slide of my lecture this afternoon, I mentioned the thermal temperature. Zero temperature or thermal temperature means most of the gravitational energy is converted into the thermal energy of the accretion flow. So because the temperature is high, so geometry is quite thick. H is all comparable to the radius, r. And because of the radial velocity is very large, so accretion is very fast, and also because geometry is thick, so the surface density is very small, so it is optically thin. So the photons, once they are produced, they can easily escape. There is no need to collide with the particles. And also this is the temperature, two temperature. I only explained just now. So the relative efficiency of the whole accretion flow is much, much lower if when the accretion rate f dot is small. So again, let's look at the energy equation. This is the gradient of the entropy. For standard synthesis, as I said just now, we have roughly this and these two terms are balanced with this. Both of them much larger than the actual term. But for the maximum dominated accretion flow, called accretion flow, we will have this term are balanced with this term. Both of them are much larger than the relative cooling. So physically, this is because for hot accretion flow, the density of accretion flow is very low. So in this case, the radiation time scale is much, much longer than the accretion time scale. So the accretion flow have known enough time to radiate their energy before they are falling onto the black hole horizon. The key reason is density is very low. So radiation is quite inefficient. However, we have a critical accretion rate for eta. Critical accretion rate means in this accretion rate, the time scale of radiation is equal to the time scale of accretion. So if the accretion rate is larger, then radiation will be very strong. So it is stronger at the maximum. So we can easily obtain the value of this critical accretion rate by these equations. Okay. When m dot is very low, this one is can be neglected. This one increases very fast with m dot. Okay. So when this equation the critical accretion rate, these two terms will become equal to each other. This will determine the critical rate of eta. This is the alpha parameter. So typically, if we use alpha equal to 0.1, the critical accretion rate will be 10 to minus 2 at the accretion rate. This is why you may remember I showed you one slide, all the accretion disk models. We divided them by the accretion rate. And minus 2 is the boundary between the hot and cold accretion flow. Okay. Because of this reason. So next question is, what will happen if the accretion wave is larger than this one? You will be, previously, people think, in this case, we can only have the standard synthetic model. But we found this is not the case. This is my own work this year. So we found that LF can be extended to higher M dot. In this case, we still have a hotter accretion flow, and it is luminous. So luminous, hot accretion flow. It is still hot accretion flow, different from the standard thin disk, but it is luminous. So this is the two key features of this solution. Well, because I have to finish before 5, I have a lot of things to talk about. So and this is not so easy to understand, frankly speaking. So I just skip this part, but I just want to tell you there is such kind of thing. So for students who are interested, you can look at my paper. So this is a global solution of ADAF and ARCAF, luminous hot accretion flow. So this is so the direction you can see. The direction in this case is negative. So the direction of the heating will rather cool. This slide shows the validity efficiency of both the ADAF and the ALHA. Okay. Both of them are hotter accretion flow. So y-axis show the validity efficiency, and x-axis show the accretion rate at the black hole horizon. So this dotted line here is the 0.1 efficiency. This is the validity efficiency of the standard thin disk SST. So you can see one significant feature is the efficiency of the hot accretion flow is a function of the accretion rate. So when the accretion rate becomes higher and higher, the efficiency will also become higher, even comparable to that of the standard thin disk. Okay. You only need to remember this thing. This is again one thing many people easily make mistake. So many people they immediately say hot accretion flow when the efficiency is always low. This is not true. Alpha radiation of the hot accretion flow. So the radiative processes we should consider including the following. One is synchroradiation. Because we have magnetic field in the accretion flow, as I emphasized. And also we have relativistic electrons. This is because for hot accretion flow, the temperature is as high as zero temperature. It is 10 to 12 over R. So when R, for example, equal to 10, means 10 Schwarzschild radii, the temperature will be as high as 10 to 11 Kelvin. So this is very high temperature. So electron in this case already reached to relativistic stage. So we have to consider synchro radiation. Okay. Usually we assume the electron is in Maxwellian distribution. And also, when we calculate the spectrum, we need to consider self-absorption of synchroradiation. This is a well-known result if you learn radiative lessons. Another process is absorption radiation. Okay. This is a collision between electrons or between ions and electrons. Okay. And another process is condensation. This is very important for X-ray astronomy. Because at least for AGN and the binary, the X-ray radiation is typically produced by this mechanism. So the meaning is there is some seed photons. Seed photons usually, for example, coming from this synchro radiation. And these seed photons will collide with relativistic electrons. Because the electrons move very fast, relativistic, so after this collision, the photons, although initially they are in a radio wave, they can obtain energy through this collision. They will get energy and become into X-ray photons. Okay. This is a basic picture. Also, we sometimes consider some other mechanism. This is where we can skip. So this is a schematic figure.
Not proton photon.
No, not photon.
Proton.
Which one? You mean this one?
Last one.
Oh. Yeah, this is a proton-proton collision.
Proton.
Yeah, they can produce a pi. Then pi will decay to produce gamma.
So
Proton photon. Okay, this I'm not familiar. This is the compton scattering, right? Maybe I need to modify my annual review paper in this too. Okay, this is a compilation. Okay, this is a seed photon spectrum. So we can see this is in a low energy regime because they are produced by synchro radiation, very low energy. So once they collide with electrons, they will get an the spectrum will move to this regime. They collide again, will move to this space. They collide again. So the total, the sum of all this spectrum will be a power. Okay.
What is the algorithm for this photon energy through this collection?
Yeah, you can imagine the up limit should be determined by the maximum energy of the electrons. So the cutoff is determined by electron temperature. So by the way, some people propose X-ray spectrum can also be produced by the synchro radiation in the jet, for example. So one important difference between that picture and this thermal condensation is the shape of the cutoff. So if we have put data in this regime, we can discriminate this between these two. And some people already did some paper. So this is the emitted spectrum by hot accretion flow. So it is much more complicated than the multi-temperature black body spectrum. So it covers quite a wide range of energy band, you can see, from radio to infrared, optical UV to hard X-ray. This is because the radiation mechanism is quite complicated now. We have synchro radiation, we have Bram synchro radiation, and compensation. So this peak actually coming from self-absorbed synchro radiation. And this coming from the first order compensation, collide once. Okay. And this is the second order compton scattering. So if for optical, for accretion rate, high accretion rate, we will have all these peaks will merge to come into a power. And the cutoff energy is determined by electron temperature. This is for stellar mass black hole and this is for super mass black hole. The physics are the same.
Oh, this
line corresponds to different accretion rate. Yeah. The higher.
What is the efficiency of direct heating of the
electrons? Mm-hmm. Okay. We use. We usually use the delta parameter here.
Yes.
So this is determined by complicated microphysics. So usually people consider two mechanisms. One is a turbulence cascade. Another one is magnetic reconnection. This is the two important viscous, so-called viscous dissipation. So people have to use some kinetic, complicated kinetic theory to study this. Generally, in summary, people now think the value of delta should be roughly 0.1, 0.2, something. 0.1 or 0.2, the maximum is 0.3, 0.5. Yeah, still more than half of the energy heat the ions, but also a significant part can directly heat the electrons. stability. Okay, we quickly skip. I already mentioned we can judge the stability by the slope of Fischer's curve. Okay, this is a data solution. This is a luminous hot equation flow solution. This in this region, it is a cold equation flow, standard thinness and stiffness. And this SLE means Shapiro-Lightman Hadley solution. So this is an old story of this community. It is a very old paper published in 1976. It turned out that this solution is somewhat unstable, so we just skip it. So anyway, all these solutions, they are suddenly, they are viscously stable. Okay. This is viscous stability. However, another thing is a convective stability. So we found that if we do not consider magnetic field, so a hot equation flow is convectively unstable. This is because the gradient of entropy is negative, which means with the decrease of the radius, the gradient, the entropy of the equation flow become higher and higher. Okay, this is a criterion to judge the convective stability. Okay. This is important because originally people think once the equation flow is convectively unstable, it can produce outflow. Outflow is quite important. Okay, this is some old story. Now people already realized in the real case, which means we have to take into account the magnetic field. In this case, accretion flow is convectively stable, not unstable. Okay. I will talk about this later. Okay. Another thing is the thermal stability. This is a little subtle. First, the sense is it is people all agree for long wavelength perturbation, accretion flow is thermally stable. But for short wavelength perturbation, people have some debate. Okay. Some people think it is stable, but some other people, including my group, we think it is unstable. Okay. Fortunately, if the accretion rate is not so high, say smaller than this value, the growth time scale of the thermal instability is longer than the accretion time scale. This means even though the accretion flow is unstable, it do not have enough time to bruise this perturbation. So the accretion flow can still survive. Okay. However, in this case, it will be a problem. Because in this case, thermal stability is a very big challenge. So this is a regime people still need to study further. Okay. I guess maybe some two-phase accretion flow will be formed. Because this is a typical risk consequence of thermal stability. Like the study of it in the interstellar medium. Okay. We will have multi-phase interstellar medium. Numerical simulation. Numerical simulation previously, beginning from the 1980s, the pioneer work was done by John Hawley and so on in Caltech. They did some hydro simulation. Later on, people began to consider MSD. John Hawley, Jim Stone, and so on, they did a lot of work in this field. Okay. So this is the general result. We found that the mass accretion rate decreased inward. Okay. And the radio profile of physical quantities, now this can be described by law. This is consistent with self-similar or analytical solution. This is a good thing. Okay. And also, the simulation found that the value of the alpha parameter is in this range. I already talked about before. Okay. Actually, alpha is quite diverse, depending on the net magnetic flux. Okay. Yeah, I just skip this movie. This is I already showed you before. Okay. This is the initial condition of MSD simulation. Then it will evolve. Okay. This again, I will just skip. So this is the snapshot of the general relativity MSD simulation. Okay. Snapshot. Okay. So this black line means the magnetic field line. This is, means the main disk body, and this is the corona region. Okay. This is a general picture, and the jet is here.
How different the result change between the with GR without GR?
Okay. You can imagine GR effect must be only important close to the black hole. So in this case, we will have a so-called ecosphere of the black hole. In within this region, the space-time will have to be co-rotated with the black hole. One consequence will be the production of the black hole that China you can get. Or special jet because the GR effect. I will talk about it later.
What is the accretion?
Huh? This is accretion rate free because there is no radiation. So it can be, this is true for any accretion rate.
No radiation.
Yeah, yeah. This is pure GRST.
I was wondering. The corona, the temperature really high. I was wondering the neutrino production. Is that important?
Yes. Yes. This is especially true for accretion disk in time records. Because in that case, not only the temperature high, but also density is quite high. So neutrino will be very heavy produced. Yeah. This is the physical picture of the neutron simulation. You can see some spiral structure and a few lines and so on. I think it is turbulence.
How can a spiral form?
Fluctuation. Because of turbulence, some fluctuation of density temperature.
That's
I don't know if it is stable or not. I think it's mainly because of fluctuation. Okay. Now we jump to chapter 4, application. Of the hot accretion flow theory. Okay. First thing is, I will talk about application in federalist and some low luminosity here, and also hot state of black hole survival. So first topic is federalist. This is the supermassive black hole in our galactic center. So why federalist is so interesting, so important? This is because this is the so far the best evidence for the supermassive black hole. So look at this figure. So all these dots in this figure, so some stars are surrounding the our galactic center. We take pictures at a different time, and you can see we can get their trajectory. Okay. So from their trajectory, we can see they have some capillary motion around some gravitational center, which is denoted by this star here. Then from the Newtonian law, we can easily calculate the mass of this gravitational center, which is about 4 million solar masses. And also you can see some orbit of the star enclose a very small space. This means this 4 million star solar mass matter must be concentrated in a very small space. So according to our current knowledge, it can only be a black hole. Not possible to be anything else. Okay. This is why we think that this is the best evidence. Okay. Because of this work, one group, which is Richard Gansel's group, he won the Shaw Astronomy Prize. Another group, which is done by UCLA group, by Andrea Guess, he was selected as the member of the National Academy of Sciences, USA, here, yes. Anyway, so this is the largest black hole on the sky, okay, so far, because of course it is located in our galactic center. So we have many detailed constraints on the black hole accretion. For example, we have direct observational deviation for the accretion rate. We have detailed observation for the boundary condition of the accretion flow. We also have quite abundant observational data, including detailed spectral energy distribution, polarization in radio waveband, and also X-ray and infrared flares, and emission lights, and so on. So the professional data is quite abundant. Oh, it is still not close enough. Yeah. So this is supply us the best laboratory to study black hole accretion, at least in the regime of low accretion rate. Okay. So first, let's talk about the gas fueling. This is the infrared image by BLT, very large telescope, okay, of the central parsec of the our galaxy, all the stars. So these stars will emit very strong stellar wind. And this stellar wind will collide at the shock and become hot enough to produce this kind of X. So this is every image taken by Chandra telescope. So by Chandra observation, we can measure the temperature of the hot gas. It is this value. And also the number density of the gas surrounding this black hole. It is roughly this value. Then we can apply our boundary accretion theory to estimate the accretion rate, as I talked about before. So we know temperature and density, so we can easily calculate the boundary radius. Of course, we already know the black hole mass, so this is roughly this value. Then we can calculate the mass accretion rate, which is 10 to minus 5 solar mass per year. It's very low accretion rate. Okay. This is estimated by the very simple boundary equation theory. In this year, some people did some detailed numerical simulation to determine the accretion rate. It turned out that only differed by a factor of 3. So it is quite good. Factor 3 for astronomy is already good enough. So now we introduce some observation. So first is the SED. This is the spectral energy distribution of these dots from the radio to X-ray wavelength. So you can see they are obtained by different very state-of-the-art telescopes. This wavelength by VLA, SMA, this is by VLT, this is by Chandra, and I have to build them. So in general, we call it in this community called the flat radio spectrum in this band. Then about 86 gigahertz, we will have a so-called sub-millimeter bump here. Okay. And also in the X-ray, we have two typical X-ray states. For the quiet state, the photon index is very large. But for the flare state, the photon index can be very large. It can be small and can also be large, quite diverse. Okay. The key point is the total luminosity of this supermass black hole is only 10 to minus 9 angstrom luminosity. It's extremely low. This is one typical feature. This is also a puzzle because you can see from the image I showed you before, there are a lot of stars surrounding this black hole. And this emits a very strong stellar wind. Why the luminosity is so low? We have such a big supermassive black hole. This is been a puzzle for many, many years. Because previously, we only have the standard synthesis model. So we can, if we apply the standard synthesis model to this source, we will easily obtain the luminosity should be several orders magnitude higher than this observed value. So why? So until the some people found an EDAF solution. I call it old EDAF because there is some development field later. Okay. For the old EDAF, the key idea is energy advection. Okay. So in this case, they explain such observation, the low luminosity of this source because they said because of energy advection. Almost all of the energy dissipated by viscous dissipation is stored in the accretion flow rather than radiated away. This is a typical feature of EDAF, okay, by radiation. Another feature is accretion rate in the recently old EDAF model is accretion rate is constant. Okay. So the success of this model is they can now roughly explain why this source is so deep, why the luminosity is so low. They can also even fit the LCD relatively well. Okay. Published the invention. However, there is also some problems. One big problem is some later new observation, especially some radio polarization observation, they found very strong linear polarization. Why this is a problem? Yeah, I will explain later. I will explain in my next slide. So this new observational result is conflict with the prediction of ADA. This is because in this old ADA picture, the density of the crystal flow close to the black hole horizon is very high. So even though central radiation is intrinsically polarized, because of the very strong Faraday depolarization effect, we should not be able to detect any linear polarization. However, we detect them. So this is why we have a problem. So this is the observational result. At this wavelength, we have a such kind of linear polarization. Okay. And this wavelength, we have such kind of value. So all this polarization observation put a very strong, strict constraint to the density of the magnetic field in the accretion flow. Because of the depolarization effect. So it turned out the rotation measure have to be smaller than this area. Okay. So some of you students may not familiar, that does not matter. Okay. So you just remember, if we see polarization, the rotation measure should not be too large. Okay. So we can convert this constraint into the accretion rate, because this put a constraint on the density and the magnetic field of the accretion flow. This can be converted into accretion rate. So accretion rate should be within this range. Okay. So remember, at the boundary radius, the accretion rate is 10 to minus 5, so less per year. But close to the black hole horizon, this new polarization observation constrain the accretion rate to be this many. This is roughly, say, 100 times smaller than the accretion rate at the boundary radius. Okay. But in the old ADA picture, the accretion rate is constant, so not change. So this is the big problem.
In terms of trading, what will be the accretion rate?
Maybe anyway is 10 to minus 2, so the mass per year. Yeah. Yeah, 10 to minus 2. So this observation immediately tells us the accretion rate must decrease in volume. So at the boundary radius, it is such a high value, but close to the horizon, the black hole, it must be much smaller value. Okay. This is because of the wind. I will talk about in the next chapter. So this is why the standard thin disk model can be ruled out the spectrum. You can see the spectrum from the synthesis with different accretion rate do not fit the observation. And this is the modified new ADA model after we take into account very strong wind. In this case, it is now satisfied radio polarization observation. So this line shows the synchron radiation from the thermal electrons. And this line shows the synchron radiation from the power on electrons, because we assume in the accretion flow we have both thermal and non-thermal electrons. Non-thermal electrons is produced by shock acceleration within the accretion flow. And also we have compensation from the thermal electrons. This longest line shows the Brampton radiation from the accretion flow. And then this thick solid line. So their total emission, you can see it can fit the spectrum well. Of course, we need to adjust some parameters. Okay. So you can see this paper is quite straightforward, because observation tells us the accretion rate must decrease in what. So we just take into account these new things. Okay. The let's jump to a question in low luminosity because the time is quite short. So this is the overview of the main observational result of the low luminosity AGN taken from this Louis Cole's paper. Some of you may know Louis Cole. This paper is his annual review paper on low luminosity AGN. Okay. So what he found is roughly half of the nearby galaxy contain low luminosity AGN. And the second galaxy are on average 10 times more luminous than the low luminosity AGN. So this is a typical luminosity of error agent in this range. So given the available accretion rate, this means consider, for example, the stellar wind, the interstellar medium, and so on surrounding the black hole. So the efficiency should be at 1 to 4 orders of magnitude lower than the efficiency of the standard cities. So this is why he argued we must need enough for low luminosity AGN. Okay. And also, the LCD also unusual compared to the typical AGN, luminous AGN like Accretion. And also, in this case, we have no broad RMI. In some cases, we have found a double peaked RMI. So this is the LCD of luminous AGN. Okay. So this is shown by the orange color. So these two blue colors show the typical luminous AGN. One is for radio loud, another one is for radio quiet. So you can see one significant difference is a lack of big blue bump in this region. This is a very typical feature for luminous, most important feature. So here is our theoretical picture to explain such quite different observational result. Why the spectrum is so different, why we have such kind of observational result. This picture actually the first proposed by Shapiro in his 1976 paper. Okay. In the region is a hot crystal, out region is a cities. Okay. But because this model is unstable, so people think there's some problem. So anyway, later people now repropose that kind of scenario. So in this picture, we have a central black hole outside of some radius, we have a thin disk. But the thin disk is truncated and replaced by a hot accretion flow like a halo. Okay. Why we have such a transition? We'll talk about in my next slide. Okay. Then in the central region, we will have the jet. Of course, we should also have wind, okay. But wind has no contribution to radiation, because radiation of the wind is quite weak, so we just need that here. So typically, the jet radiation will contribute to the radio and the infrared. For the thin disk, usually contribute to optical UV, and for the hot accretion flow, we will contribute to the X-ray. This is a general picture. So why we have such a kind of transition from thin disk to a hot accretion flow? So one picture people proposed is an evaporation model. This is proposed by a Mayer couple in MPA, a German scientist. So the basic picture is there is some hot corona and thin disk. And between this corona and the thin disk, there will be very strong thermal conduction. Okay. This thermal conduction will transport some heat to the underlying thin disk. So underlying thin disk will evaporate. And gradually, with the decrease of accretion rate, more and more matter in the thin disk will evaporate. So finally, the whole thin disk will disappear, replaced by hot accretion flow by this mechanism. This is a basic picture. This is the detailed numerical calculation result. So we show the truncation radius as a function of the accretion rate. Another picture is proposed by some Japanese colleagues. Homa, do you know this picture? Okay. This is my mom, Roji, my mom. No. This is a solid cathode. So they propose, they call it a turbulent energy transportation. So this is the mathematical description of this mechanism. So you can see this is somewhat similar to the convection. It is a gradient of the entropy, something like this. But here they say this is not convection, but turbulence. This kind of radio energy heat in the radio direction. So this is will transport the heat from small radii to large radii. So once the accretion flow at large radii get enough heat from by this mechanism, the whole synthesis will become suddenly become into a hot accretion flow. This is very similar to kind of a phase transition. So this is the numerical calculation result. It just put this additional energy term into the equation and solve the accretion equations. This is the result we obtain. Okay. You can see there is a transition. This is temperature. Suddenly the temperature jump up, becomes very high, become into hot accretion flow. So we summarized from by combining theoretical and observational studies to show this result. This is so the transition radius is a function of the accretion of luminosity, okay, for different sources. For example, for Sagittarius star, this is a very, very dim source. I just talk about a truncated radius. It actually is very large. There is no synthesis at all in this Sagittarius star. For MNS-7, it's also similar. But for very famous X-ray binary, it should be within this range. For luminosity AGN, it should be roughly this value. So anyway, you can see with the decrease of the accretion rate, the truncation radius becomes larger and larger. This is fully consistent with these two theoretical scenarios people proposed and just introduced. So now I show you some concrete sources. One is M87, this is a famous AGN. So just look at this spectrum here. These are obtained by HST. Okay. So these four dotted lines show the spectrum predicted by standard synthesis model without truncation. We just adjust any parameter, any possible parameter in the synthesis model, try to fit this HST spectrum. However, you can see it is not successful. This solid line here shows the truncated synthetic spectrum. You can see roughly can fit the spectrum. Okay. This is a good evidence for the truncation of the synthetic. Okay. And this figure, compared to this left plot, we now add the spectrum or add up. In this plot, we only show the truncated synthetic. So now we can see we can also fit the X-ray spectrum. This is another example. This is quite similar. Actually, they take it from the same paper by Elliot Porter, John's colleague in Brooklyn. Another one is NGC 1907. This is a very famous source because of the existence of the double peak arm line. Okay. So if you are familiar with this field, you will know this is a very famous source. So by fitting the double peak line, we can obtain, not we, but they, because this is other people's work, they obtain the truncation radius value, which is roughly this value. So anyway, they to expand such kind of double peak the R line, they also get the truncation facilities, and they obtain the value of the truncation radius. Then, we try in our work, we try to fit the SED with the same picture. We not to try to fit the double peak the iron line, but to fit the SED. We found that we use the same value of the truncation radius, we can fit the SED. So two completely independent approach, we obtain roughly the same result. This is, I think this is also another good evidence for such kind of a general picture. This is a scientist in Brazil, came to Shanghai to work with me. just skip. So now we talk about the one black hole S3 binary, okay, XDEJ11-18. This is again very famous black hole binary. For this source, it never went into high soft state, always in the hot state, even in the outflow state. So first thing is, for this source, it's located in the high latitude, so the absorption is quite weak, so we can obtain quite good EUV data here. So this data is very important because they can give very good constraint to the spectrum in this energy range. And this can, as I talked about for MNT1, this can constrain the truncation, the synthesis. So by fitting this UV data, we can obtain the truncation radius roughly this value, 300 Schwarzschild radii. Okay. This is one thing. Another thing is, for a good thing for this source is, we detect the PPO. Okay. PPO is cordially periodic oscillation in both X-ray and optical waveguide. So by fitting this PPO, this PPO frequency is in this range. Okay. So one proposed model for PPO is the P-mode oscillation of ADA. P-mode oscillation means ADA is spherical-like, geometrically thick. So it will oscillate in this way. This is called the P-mode oscillation. Okay. Using this scenario to explain PPO will give us another independent constraint on the value of the truncation radius, which is roughly also this value. So for the same source, we can obtain constraint on the truncation radius from fitting SED and from explained PPO, and obtain the same result. So this is another good example. Of course, now people have proposed a different model to explain TPO, but the result is almost the same with this one. This figure, I only show the spectrum by this ADAF and truncated synthesis, this one. You can see it can fit the spectrum in this energy range quite well, but not so good in this energy range. Okay. This is optical, this is infrared. We think this is because we have not taken account the radiation from the jets in this picture. Okay. So this plot, we now added the component of the jet radiation. So you can see, especially for the radio radiation, it must come from the jet. And also the jet also contribute somewhat to the infrared and also optical. Okay. So for the jet parameter, we found that we should use roughly, assume 5% of the accretion material is transferred into the jet. So I point out this value because first thing is this is a free parameter in our model. The second thing is this value, 5%, is fully consistent with numerical simulation result. So MHD numerical simulation for jet formation typically give us 1 to 10%. So you should not only try to fit observation. You should also be careful whether your proposed scenario is reasonable. This is also very important. Radio X-ray correlation, I quickly say something about it. This is observational result. So this combined many AGN and black hole S3 binary. This is radio luminosity. This is X-ray luminosity combined with the black hole mass. Okay. People found the such correlation. So that's the question, that's the thing. Task for series is how to explain such kind of correlation. So this is why the motivation of this work. So we found that to explain such correlation, we need the radio radiation coming from the jet, X-ray radiation coming from the hot pushing flow. Okay. We then extend this correlation a little bit further. Namely, we not only explain the existing observation, we also try to do to give some prediction. This is also very useful to check theoretical model. So this is our prediction. So basically, we found this is observed correlation in this regime. When the accretion rate or luminosity is very low, we predict the correlation will become steeper, become into this shape. The power index will be 1.2. Observe the high luminosity regime, the correlation index is 0.7. So this regime is our prediction. Then we found, later we found some observational tests to constrain, to check our model is correct or not. Okay. So I just mentioned this paper. This is after our paper, right? This 2008. So this in this work, they observed two luminosity gain. One is NGC, another one is this one. So this is the observed radio luminosity in this unit, of course. And this is a predicted luminosity by our 2005 work. You can see they differ by a factor of smaller than 3. Smaller than 3, again, it is good. It's already good enough, I think. This is a real. After the theoretical prediction checked and confirmed by observation 3 years later. So, so this is the, in this year, 2009, my student and I, and also Louis Ho, we, because of that, in this year, we already have good data, we already have enough good data to directly check our prediction. So, maybe we directly see the correlation. So this is, we just put our observational data into this plot, and we found the correlation index is 1.22. So remember our theoretical prediction 1.23. Okay, thank you. This is the end of the
talk. Very good. So it's about 5 o'clock now. So you may take a walk in the campus and then please come back at 6 o'clock to join the reception party here, right outside this lecture room. Okay? Yep. So see you later.
Thank you.